We are continuing the series of books of the Bible. This is the last book of the Old Testament. Now, we kind of didn't go straight through. We stopped, went in Lent, we went through prophets and so forth. So we're ending kind of in the middle, but it's the book of the writings is what we're going through now. And the writings, Job, Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon, remember, they are called, they're called many things, but I like to call them a journal of the human soul. These five books we've been going through lately are human beings' thoughts, expressions, feelings to the deepest core of their being. And now we're talking about love. Song of Solomon and all the other books of these five, I like to call it the human cry. That's what's coming out of these books. And today it's the cry for love. And it's about sensual love, about sex as well. It's hard for me to say that. I'm Norwegian, and my mom and dad told me there was no Santa Claus before they told me there wasn't a stork. So I think I was 15. Anyway, I don't want to blame my parents. But, you get a little red going to the Song of Solomon. You really do. In fact, I put some verses together here, but I couldn't put all the verses I wanted together. I guess I got a little embarrassed. Now, throughout history, early history in Christian church, the church has almost always thought of it as an allegory of God's love for us is like a man's love for a woman or a woman's love for a man. In fact, at Luther's time, Luther was in Germany back in the 1500s, and there was a man named Calvin, a great theologian, who was in Geneva, Switzerland. And that town had a theocracy. Their governing leaders were all Christians, and you had to go to church, and you had to abide by their rulings and so forth. There was a man who had the guts to say, as he looked at Song of Psalms, that this truly is not an allegory, but it is about a love between a man and a woman. Now, today, that's kind of standard thinking. It's just hard to get around it. It's a love between a man and a woman. And it's told, if this is Solomon, who it's attributed to, then it's 1,000 BC. It's 3,000 years ago. We long for intimate love, and we long for relationship. And here's some verses I could say. Let him kiss me with the kisses of his mouth, for your love is more delightful than wine. That's chapter 1, verse 2. 1, verse 4 says, let the king bring me into his chambers. 2:7, do not arouse or awaken love until it so desires. We just heard that from Terry. 6:3, I am my beloved, and my beloved is mine. 5:1, drink your fill of love. I mean, this is good stuff. What does it say? It says that sex is a gift from God. It's a very important point here. Thank God for this book. Because through the ages, churches and theologians and groups of Christians have gotten off kilter with sex and a love between a man and a woman and have said some pretty bizarre things. Thank God this book is in here because we get the truth of God's perspective on marriage and a love between a man and a woman. And he gives it as a gift, a great gift. There's two truths about sex. First of all, it's a beautiful gift from God. It's a gift from God. It is a wondrous, majestic, amazing gift from God. Two, sex has been used to harm countless people in significant ways. This room alone, there's over 100 people here. You heard statistics, right? Most of us have been damaged by sex that was not used properly or appropriately, or that was governed by lust and evil intentions and so forth. That's why this is an important issue, because of all the damage and harm that's done when it's misunderstood or when it's let out of the box and there's no limits. Sex is a beautiful stream that becomes dangerous if it overflows its banks. Just think of a big river. I grew up in the Mississippi River, just about a 50-foot cliff, and we saw some rapids in Minnesota, but it was still fairly wide at that point, and it was beautiful. But during flood season, it becomes dangerous. Sex, if it stays within the channels ordained for it by God, is a beautiful, safe thing. But it's It's when it's flooded. And by the way, everybody, this may come as a shock to you, this culture and what they're doing with sex, there's a flood happening. And this flood is gigantic and it's huge. It's taken out huge areas. When Grand Forks, years ago, Grand Forks, and what's a little thing called winter, there was so much snow that winter that the Red River that flows north, which doesn't make sense, what was God thinking? And there was a flood, and my dad took a little plane, paid for my brother-in-law and me to go up from Fargo to Grand Forks and see how wide this river was. But it's not the river, it's the river plus the flooding. We got a big, and it was huge. Downtown Grand Forks was all burned to the ground. You could see it from our plane. There is a flood happening on sexuality in our country, a flood, and it is being twisted and turned and misused and misguided, and this is hurting so many people. It's a problem. It's an issue that's getting worse and worse and worse. Solution? Protect this gift with appropriate rules and regulations. Like, for instance, this plate. This plate, we got at a garage sale. Porcelain. I heard porcelain. We got this at a garage sale. And, oh! That wasn't the one we got for Christmas or for a wedding present, was it? Okay, yeah, it broke. Wow, that's a lot of pieces. Honey, this is the expensive one, right? Whew, thank you. This plate was cheap. We let our kids use it for Frisbees. We let them wash dishes after major events in our family. Not this. Honey, you get a little nervous? You may want to come up and hold it, like Vanna White a little bit. These are expensive plates. We got them for our wedding. Those are cheap. Anybody can use them. They're everyday wear is what we call them. This is not. This is special. It has significance for us emotionally, but it's also valuable. What do we do with it? What do you do with your valuable dishes? Hide them. Yes, you hide them. And a lot of times, though, you hide them is in a china cabinet, correct? Our plates and everything are in a china cabinet with a little lock. These are precious. Our kids were not allowed when they were little to wash these after Thanksgiving meal. They were not. This isn't cheap. And so we protect it. We guard it. We put it where it's safe. You know, the world, I think, many times have had a view of Christians like, you guys don't think much of sexuality or sex because you don't do it very often, which is not necessarily true at all. But the point is, you guys have so many restrictions on it and so forth. We think it's valuable because we use it all the time. No, it's cheap when you use it all the time. You know that the church is one of the last bastions of belief that sex is beautiful and wondrous? One of the last bastions. We believe it's so precious that it has to be safeguarded, right? Protected. Well, and it's protected with marriage. You know, we wait till marriage before we have relations of that kind. Oops. Sorry, hon. You understand we need to protect it. We have rules and regulations. Why? Because it's so valuable. Not because it's not worth anything. Because it's so valuable. So valuable. The present culture has divorced sex from morality. Sex and morality have always gone together. It was a moral, this is a moral issue, not anymore. You notice younger people under 40, it's not a moral issue. There's no thought that it's wrong. Out of the last 20 weddings I've had, over half of them were real Christians. None were not living together. None. It doesn't exist anymore in my world. There's zero. Dedicated Christians have been sold on the point, and they're not embarrassed because they don't think it's a moral issue anymore. Our culture through media has made it so that we think that sex is not worth anything. And the opposite is true. The opposite is true. Morality, sex has everything to do with morality. Why? Because it does such great harm. There's so, in this room, dozens of us have been hurt by sex. My family was devastated multiple times because of things that happened. This is a very precious thing, and it's such an evil tool. Do you know how many girls are stolen and used for sex as sex slaves? I mean, you know how many times date rape? You know how many times rape? You know how many times even pornography? I always want to talk to men about pornography because we think over half of Christian men are addicted or somehow involved with pornography. And what comes with that is incredible guilt. Incredible guilt. And we want to free ourselves from guilt while still trying to do what's right. I mean, objectifying women is wrong. All I'm saying is in this room, we have all been hurt by this wondrous gift because there's no restraint. There's no self-control. And now our culture is just waving us on and saying, you do anything you want to. What their thought is just be safe, you know, be safe, consenting and be safe. If I talk to kids in pre-marriage counseling, it's just like a deer with headlights in his eyes. It does not comprehend that sex is a moral issue. But again, why is it moral? Because it does such great evil. It causes such great evil in the wrong hands or in our hands when we allow it to distort us. So, there was a Dodge City girl. We lived in Dodge City, and there's a woman who was about 23, and she called, and she's going to live with her boyfriend, but she wanted to talk to the pastor first. So her mother came with, we met at Wendy's, and she wanted to know my thoughts about living together. And by the way, the folks said that they will not pay for the wedding if they are living together. But she came, and she was determined to do this, and we talked. Do you know that I defended no sex before marriage without using the Bible? You don't need the Bible. I talked to her about what happens if you move in together, you become linked like marriage, and hard to break that. And when you discover that it's not the right person, many don't get out of it. You're too locked in. It takes control out of women's lives. It takes control. My niece, Christine, in high school, she wanted to be pure until marriage. Guess what? When she had a boy ask her out, she knew his intentions were pure. You understand? You see that? And also, I thought that she'd been mocked and laughed at and scorned. Instead, there were girls that came to her because they respected it so much and they wanted to be like that because of all the harm and damage that is done. Now, there's forgiveness. When we've done things that we shouldn't have sexually, there's forgiveness. If you're intent on continuing to try to work on this, and by the way, I encourage you to see a counselor, a Christian counselor, if you need to, because many of you have been hurt in so many ways. And again, the list is too long to mention all the harms that can be done. But there's forgiveness. Some of you have had an abortion. And you've been guilty, just guilty. You wonder if God loves you. He does love you. He does forgive you. And you need to hear that. You need to hear that. And the list is long. You need to know that God forgives these sins. In some cases, you may have to do some restitution or something as far as relationship or reconciliation or whatever. This is a tough issue because this topic is so great and it's so awful. It's so great and it's so awful. The two men in my early Christian life, starting at age 13 to college, the two men I respected most that were Christian leaders, both ended up being a pedophile. I mean, they sought young people out. It's rampant and it's getting worse because there's the barriers are coming down and the culture is waving us on and our children on as well. Okay, so it's a great thing. It's a really tough thing. But also, I'm going to go back to the allegory. We can also take this as allegory. It's both, right? This definitely talks about this pure, right, healthy relationship between a man and a woman. But it also talks about God's desire for intimacy with us. Intimacy is something that Lutherans don't talk about a lot. Norwegians certainly don't talk about intimacy a lot. And we are, I mean, my colleagues and I are very brain-oriented and intellectual-oriented. I heard a speaker, he's a theologian from Dallas Seminary, used to be, and he said he just loved the Word of God, and he studied it and taught it his whole life. And then I heard him as a speaker, retired, and he said, you know, I'm now realizing I left out intimacy. I just took this knowledge, kept building it, but I didn't work on my intimacy with God. This book in the Bible shows God's interest in intimacy because he many times links marriage to relationship with God, that we're the bride, right? It's all over the place in the scriptures. Why? Because God just doesn't want us to know about him. He wants us intimate with him. He wants us to have a prayer life that talks to God as if he's real and he can do anything. So I think we need to just be aware that there's more to Christian life than just studying, just understanding things. It is knowing this person, getting to know them better and better as you live with them deliberately through your life. Paul said this in Ephesians 5, a man will leave his father and mother and be united with his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This is a profound mystery, but I'm talking about Christ and his church. He twists it all of a sudden. He says, he's talking about a man and a woman relationship. Then he says, like Christ and the church. However, each of you also must love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband. So, it is an allegory too. It talks about, God always loves to talk about marriage when he talks about life with him, because it's very similar. And then finally, I want to pray this morning, because there's a lot of people that need healing. A lot of you need healing because of what's done, what's happened in the past, or whatever. And I want you, some of the guilt that you've been struggling with because you feel bad about whatever, it can stay here and you can leave without it. Today would be a good day to just walk away from these feelings. Also, a lot of times there's going to be unforgiveness. Hate is also going to be there, and God demands that we work through that no matter what the situation. So I want to pray just for all of us on this issue and for the healing. Let's pray. God, we thank you for this incredible gift, this beautiful, wondrous, amazing gift of a relationship with another human being that is so close and so intimate. We thank you for Jesus Christ, that you've come into our life, and now you invite us also into our life every day. Help us to groom a more intimate relationship with you. Help us with that. God, I pray for those here today who've been wounded or scarred or damaged or hurt because of sex outside the boundaries, outside the banks. I pray, oh God, that you would help those who can't believe that you would still love them. Realize that you still love them. We pray for just the pain that's been experienced. We pray for healing emotionally, mentally, relationally. We pray for healing. And we pray, Lord Jesus, that we would find people who can help us, steer us the right way, give us encouragement and hope. But Lord, I pray for healing for all of us where there's been injury done in this regard. In Jesus' name, amen.